y'all, what's up? My name is Averie, and today I'm going to be giving you some romance recommendations. So I'm going to be recommending you 13 books today. These 13 books are my favorite books from 2021 so far. So right now it is the middle to end of July, so these are my top 13 books that I have read so far this year that are romance books, and so I'm here to recommend them to you. First we have my most recent read, which is Phoenix Unbound by Grace Draven. Oh my word, I loved this book. This is a fantasy romance book all about our main heroine named Jolene, and Jolene lives in this village, and she has magical powers. She's able to put on an illusion, and she's able to walk through and not burn from fire, and has the ability to control fire. Her village is one of these small villages, a part of the giant empire, and every year they have the goddess of spring sacrifice in the empire, where they basically get a young maiden from every village and burn them at the stake in this empire arena. It's brutal. And so our heroine, for the past 5 years, has been putting on an illusion of a new woman every single year, and she goes to the empire and makes it seem like she burns in the pyre, but she casts an illusion over herself and she leaves. And so her putting on this illusion of this person every single year, a new person every year, guarantees that nobody in her village will actually die. But with her fire, with her illusions, there does come consequences. So the beginning of this book, she is brought to the empire yet again for the 5th year. And one of the gladiators there notices that a gladiator slave, like he's enslaved to the empire to fight, basically. He has been noticing and can see through her glamour. So he knows that this woman has been coming here for 5 years. And so he decides to bargain with her and tells her that he won't tell anybody he knows who she really is if she helps him escape the empire. And so she does what he asks. She pretends to burn at the fire. She ends up saving him. And then she's like, okay, I'm done with you. We're on our merry way. Bye. I paid you off. You paid me off. We're squat. We're good to go. And then as she turns to leave the empire and go back to her village, he kidnaps her and is on the journey to bring her to his village. And you learn about why and why he does that when you read the book, but I adored this, y'all. This is an enemies to lovers kidnapping romance. It is hot, heavy, kind of slow burn because it is enemies to lovers, but the world building in here, and you can totally see the shift from enemies to lovers in this one. It was beautifully written. I adored this one. Next is King Size by Jessa Kane. This is actually one of her novellas that I fell in love with. This is about Rex and Britta. Britta, at the beginning of this book, becomes queen of her land because her two parents ended up passing away. I believe she's 18. So she's now the queen to this land. Rex is one of her many bodyguards. Now, Rex hasn't been a bodyguard his whole life. He used to be a blacksmith, but then one day on a parade, like one of the royal parades, he ends up seeing Britta and is like, that princess, back then she was a princess, is beautiful and amazing. I think she can do great things for our country. I'm going to dedicate my life to protecting her. And so he enlists to be a guard, so he's been her guard for a while now. And so the beginning of this book, he hears Britta and a bunch of the guards outside her door. He hears Britta crying because her parents are dead. So he's just like, is nobody gonna go console this woman who's clearly upset and crying, and like nobody but him will go do it? And so he goes in there and consoles her, and they end up becoming close, and it turns into something more and gets kind of hot and heavy. I loved this. There's an age gap in here. If you love age gap romances, we have kind of a bigger hero, a sweet cinnamon roll hero. I loved him. This romance was just like so swoon worthy for just a little Jessa Kane novella. I still think about this book to this day. Next I have Nerdgasm by Kimberly Reese. This is a college romance. This is about Theo and Addison. Theo is actually a teacher's assistant, so a TA in one of the classes that Addison is taking. So the first day of class, Addison sees Theo being the TA at the front of the classroom and instantly knows that she wants him. So she's kind of the pursuer in this instance, and Theo's a very shy guy, kind of nerdy, and he has a stutter. So he's been kind of hesitant and kind of shy around women because he doesn't want them to judge him. Addison, she thinks he is the cutest thing ever. I love Theo in this so much. He's also a virgin hero, so you have that trope in here that I adore. This is a book that also is a change of pace because the couple in here kind of takes their time to become fully intimate with one another, and I really liked that progression and the slow movement towards that because that's personally what I would do. And so I kind of liked seeing myself more in a relationship, whereas in romance books I do love tend more to jump straight into the action, you know. So I kind of just loved the slow progression in here, but it was hot. For the slow progression that it was hot, y'all. Next is another slow burn romance. We have Just a Heartbeat Away by Cara Bastone. This is a single parent romance, kind of also a workplace romance. The hero in here, he has a young son. At the beginning of this book, you read about how his wife recently passed and he's kind of struggling to provide and take care of his son. His son's kindergarten teacher kind of pulls him into a teacher conference and is like, hey, here are some tips and tricks to helping raise your son. I know that you're probably having a hard time going through the trauma and the travesty your family is going through. And so it's a couple years later, he still keeps the list of things that this woman has given him, and still thanks her to this day, like in his brain. He hasn't seen her in years until the beginning, after the prologue of this book, where he finds out that she is the guidance counselor for her son, for his son's new school. So it's a couple years later, he's still in elementary school, but she's now the guidance counselor for this new school. And he ends up also being like the parent on lunch duty a lot. So they end up being in professional development meetings and bonding meetings for the school and everything. This is very slow burn. Both of them are going through some stuff. He is quite older than her, so he's trying to get over the fact that this young woman wants him so badly when she just wants to love this man and this child and have a family. And this author can do slow burn romances. I love to see a couple fully fall for one another. And that's what this book shows you. That's what the other book in the series also shows you as well. Next is my favorite book of the year so far. We have Act Your Age, Eve Brown by Talia Hibbert. I love this book, y'all. This is about Eve Brown, and she's kind of like a trust fund baby. She lives off of the trust fund that her parents have provided for her. Her family is quite rich. At the beginning of this book, her parents kind of sit her down and are like, hey, we're cutting you off. Because you have not kept a steady job for over a year, and until you can do that, you're not getting your money. And so she's like, okay. And so she drives around kind of like looking for something, getting off some steam, whatever. And she comes across this bed and breakfast that has a help wanted sign in their window. So she decides to just pop her head in. Turns out they're actually doing interviews at the moment for the chef at the bread and breakfast. Jacob is the owner of this bed and breakfast. And right when Eve walks in the door, he immediately does not like her. She is wet from the rain. She has no resume. She has weird sayings on her shirt. She has strange purple hair. It disrupts his orderly life, basically. That's what she does. And so he immediately knows that he does not like her. Eve is very, not put off by, but kind of like drawn to this man who immediately doesn't like her. She just thinks it's hilarious. And so, long story short, she ends up accidentally hitting him with her car once the interview is over. It's an accident. It's not on purpose. And so, long story short, she ends up helping him nurse him back to health in his bed and breakfast, and also help the bed and breakfast stay afloat while he is recuperating. And they have to share kind of like a living space, living situation while this is going on. So it's kind of like a forced proximity there. So Jacob slowly grows from enemies to friends to lovers, and it's beautiful. I love this. This relationship is top tier, amazing. I love this. Next, I have Love in the Wild by Emma Castle. This is a Tarzan retelling. So think of the live action Tarzan movie with Margot Robbie. That's kind of what this book is kind of based off of. And I loved it. It's very different in ways, but I feel like it's quite similar also. This is about Thorn, and he was in a plane crash with his parents when he was a baby. His parents ended up getting murdered and he was left by himself in the jungle. Some gorillas came over and rescued him. Then is years later, and our heroine Eden ends up coming into this forest. I believe she's a photographer, and I think she's trying to do a piece for a National Geographic, if I'm not mistaken, or some famous magazine. And so she ends up getting kind of like raided by these evil men who may or may not have also killed Thorn's parents. Her whole party that she's traveling with ends up getting murdered, but she ends up getting saved by Thorn, this grown up Thorn now. And he ends up saving her, and they live in the jungle, and she and him get to know each other. And it very Tarzan and Jane-esque. I love Tarzan so much, and so this book just really spoke to me. Then we have one people might think is weird, but I loved, which is I Married a Lizard Man by Regine Abel. Y'all, don't let the title and the cover fool you. This book is good. If you like alien romances, if you love monster romances, if you love friends to lovers, arranged marriages, pick this up. Don't let the cover and title fool you. It is good. Don't let it intimidate you. Don't judge a book by its cover. Don't do it. Don't do it. Our heroine in here is Susan. She ends up getting into this mail order bride situation with Alex, who is on another planet. And she really wants to just find a new way of life because the planet that she's living on isn't really doing it for her. So she decides to go into this mail order bride program, and she gets married to Alex. And Alex is a lizard man, essentially. Kind of looks like what you see on the cover. And his people and customs are quite different from her own. She's the only human woman a part of this lizard group of people. And so it's kind of like a culture shock for her and for them. And it's just about them getting to know each other, learning about each other, having healthy, amazing communication skills, y'all. Amazing. It's very much like Radiance, that I love, my favorite romance book of all time, where where one character is thrust into a new environment with a new group of people and isn't really familiar with their culture, and both of them are just trying to become friends and get to know each other while they are married. And then slowly that will start to form into a romantic relationship that I loved. I read this one a couple days ago. Adored it. Adored it. Next is Spoiler Alert by Olivia Dade. I feel like this one was well beloved last year. I think it came out last year. And I just got around to reading it this year, and I loved this. I surprisingly loved this because I normally do not like celebrity or famous people romances. I feel like this is an exception. This is about April and Marcus. So April and Marcus both love writing fan fiction for this TV show. The TV show is kind of inspired by Game of Thrones. It's very Game of Thrones-esque. So they love writing fan fiction based off of this show. Little does April know that the guy she's been chatting with online, like they've been reading each other's fan fictions and giving each other feedback and being friends for years. They don't know who the actual person behind the screen is. They've never asked each other. Didn't feel like they needed to. But Marcus is actually one of the lead characters of this TV show. And he decided to start writing fan fiction because he didn't like the path his character was written and going down. So he started writing fan fiction for what he wanted his character to do. If the TV program or the TV show ever found out that he was doing this, he'd probably get fired. So he keeps it a secret. And so April, she decides to one day post one of her cosplay outfits that she made that's inspired by this show. And she kind of gets a lot of backlash from it online because she is plus size. And apparently that does not jive well with people, which is horrible. So Marcus, not knowing that that's his friend online, decides to ask April out, like, on a date. Again, not knowing that that's his fan fiction friend. And so they go on a date, and then they get to know one another. Marcus realizes soon that that's who he writes fan fiction with, and it's about him trying to maybe keep it a secret, but maybe also not, and wanting to tell her and also not wanting to tell her. I feel like this is only one of the few exceptions that I have for celebrity slash famous person romances, because normally I can't stand it. This one, I loved it. I loved their relationship. I loved just the talk of fan fiction and fan culture. I loved this. Next I have Dearest Rogue by Elizabeth Hoyt. This is book number 8, a part of the Maiden Lane series. I've only read book number 7 and book number 8, so I haven't read the rest of the series. I know I need to. So this book is a historical romance, if you could not tell, all about Lady Phoebe. And she is blind, and her brother, who I believe is a duke or some higher person, decides to hire her a bodyguard to help her navigate the ways of society since she is blind. And he doesn't want her to get trampled by a horse or a carriage or by somebody, so he hires Lord James Trevelyan to just keep watch over her, basically like be her bodyguard slash companion to make sure that she's not getting into any trouble or nobody's causing her any trouble. And so this is a romance between Lady Phoebe and her bodyguard James Trevelyan. This is also an age gap. He is quite older than her. He's a little put off by it. They slowly start to get to know one another and then fall for one another. This guy is smitten over this woman, smitten over her. He thinks that she deserves way better than him, but she just wants him. That's all she wants. That's all she cares about is him. And I love that in a romance. I love that. I just thought their romance was so swoon-worthy, and I want more. I want more about them, but unfortunately we don't. I need to read the rest of the series and hopefully they pop up in the other books. Then I have The Fae King's Curse by Jamie Schlosser. This is a fae romance that I loved. I loved this. This is about Kyrian and Quinn. Kyrian and Quinn met when they were 12 years old. Kyrian came from a fae land portal and Quinn lives in the human realm, our world. She didn't know that portals in other worlds existed until he pops up in her land. She ends up saving him, rescuing her from the river that is a part of her land, her family's land. They end up becoming friends that day. This little boy, this little girl, 12 years old. But he has to go back home. And so she goes and walks him to his portal. And that sparks a years-long relationship, friendship between the two of them. This book is very interesting because in this fae portal land, 1 year equals 1 day on the human realm. So our heroine sees the hero every single day from when she's 12 to 18. But the hero only sees her once a year because the time is different where he's from. And so he basically ages every single day right in front of her eyes. He stops aging once he reaches like a certain age, maybe like 20 or something. I don't remember. And so they meet on her time every day until she's 18. And they become best friends. They do everything together. They both have feelings for one another, but they've never acted on it. So one day she comes up to him and is like, hey, I won't be seeing you for quite a while. I'm about to go off to college. And he's like, no, I don't want you to leave me. I don't want to leave you. You're my best friend. I need you. And so he takes her and snatches her and brings her through the portal with him this time. She's never been over to his side of the land. And so it's all about her getting to know him in his fae realm and just them admitting their feelings for one another finally. This book is quite unique in the fact that our hero is a fae king, and when he was younger, a curse was put on all of the fae royalty to make them blind, and they're not able to get their sight back until they find their lifelong true mate and consummate their relationship. However, there is a little trick in there, is if you end up even kissing somebody who is not your mate, you'll be forever blind for the rest of your life. So our heroine is very much like hesitant on kissing him or them admitting their feelings for one another because she's scared that his mate will come into the picture one day. But he just wants her. He doesn't care about a lifelong mate. He just wants her. But she may or may not be his actual mate. You never know. Who knows? Next, I have A Man in Charge by Laurelyn Page. I really like this one. I read this one pretty recently. This is about our heroine. She kind of works for this company where she links big businesses with charities and hopes for the big businesses sponsoring certain charities. So the beginning of this book, she means to go to a party with her best friend, but her best friends end up having a flare up. Her best friend has my chronic illness, which is POTS, which is why I love this book so much. So she is not able to attend with her. So she goes to this party, our heroine goes to this party alone, and she ends up just going on the roof in the middle of the party to call her friend to ask how she's doing. And there she sees the hero of this book getting it on with another woman in the roof, like in public, like nobody else is on the roof. So she ends up watching them. She ends up by some means spending the night with him. She ends up getting with him and she goes along her merry way the next morning. Little does she know that her big appointment that she has recently for this big company is with his company. And she ends up walking into the boardroom and there he is sitting right there. So this is a office romance that gets quite hot and heavy in the boardroom. I really enjoyed this one. This one does end on a cliffhanger, so just beware. You have to read it as a duet. The second one is out. You have to read them together because, yeah. The first one ends on a cliffhanger. You're gonna want to read book two. I know I did. Next I have Only When It's Us by Chloe Lise. Y'all have been telling me to read this for forever. I finally read it, and of course, I loved it. This is another college romance. Our hero and heroine are in the same economics or math class of some sort. I don't know. But our heroine here, she is on the college soccer team. Her lifelong dream has always been to play soccer professionally, and she's made that her lifelong goal. Our hero, who sits next to her in this college class, used to play soccer and is a huge soccer fanatic. However, he lost his hearing a couple years ago due to meningitis, and he hasn't really been able to hear all that well since. Our heroine ends up sitting next to the hero, and she asks him for last class period's notes because she missed it because she was in practice, and he doesn't hear her. She thinks that he is ignoring her, and she immediately dislikes him because he won't answer her. But little does she know, he's actually deaf and just can't hear her, and man, when she figures that out, she is putting her foot in her mouth, y'all. But this is still very bickery, enemies to lovers. It's kind of like enemies to frenemies to lovers. That's what they call each other. They call each other frenemies a lot. But they're also paired by the professor to be project partners. They have to do a project together. And so they have to work together very reluctantly with one another. And it's just a romance between the two of them that I adored and I loved. And I can't wait to read the rest of the series. I feel like Chloe Lee's just has like amazing, diverse romances that I can't wait to dive into. And lastly, I have When She Belongs by Ruby Dixon. Five stars. Ruby Dixon is a goddess, especially with this book, y'all. This is book number 4, a part of the Rizdiverse series. You probably know about the Ice Planet Barbarian series. Everyone has read that. Almost everyone has read that. I love it. You know, the Rizdiverse is one of her other romance series dealing with aliens and human women falling in love. And so I really recommend reading them in order. You don't necessarily have to, just previous characters do pop up in this. And you kind of get a backstory to the heroine if you read the book before this one, so book number 3. If anything, if you only want to read this book, just read book 3 before this one and you will get more insight into the heroine of this book. So the heroine of this book, she is on this pirate spaceship, and the crew that she's with really wants to go on this dangerous mission, but they don't want to endanger their friend who is traveling with them, so they end up entrusting their other friend who lives on this abandoned asteroid to take care of her. Well, not take care of her, just to have board for her while they go on this dangerous mission. So she ends up getting abandoned kind of by her friends on this asteroid with this very grumpy alien Masaka male. And y'all, Jarek and Sophie, that is the couple in here. Jarek. Ooh, alien names, y'all. So he is very grumpy and he immediately does not want Sophie to be there. He likes his alone time. That's why he lives on an abandoned asteroid all by himself. But Sophie kind of starts to break down his walls. She's still getting over the fact that she used to be a alien's slave. And so she's still trying to get over that. And Jarek helps her through that. And yeah, I love this. There's also a alien pet in here that is the cutest thing ever, that just loves Sophie with every fiber of his being. I adore a grumpy hero that turns soft for the heroine, and that is the epitome of this book, y'all. The audiobook in here is fantastic. Please check it out. So there you have it. Those are my favorite romances of 2021 so far. Please let me know down below if you've read any of these books or if you plan to. But anyways, thank y'all so much for watching. I will see y'all soon in my next one. Bye, y'all.